Good evening, and we are going to be talking about one of my favorite T20 teams today, Arun. West Indies are going to be playing a T20, and you know I always look forward to West Indies playing this format of cricket. Initial thoughts about West Indies South Africa T20 series starting.
My first thoughts when I looked at the calendar, Akhil, is, hey, this is the 5-match series. You know, how often have we seen a 5-match bilateral T20 series? It just tells you that all this is in preparation for that
T20
T20 World
World Cup.
Cup. You know, it explains the scheduling. But yeah, I mean, two exciting sides, and I'm looking forward to it. While we're on this, you know, you've got to remember this. I'm just looking up the schedule, Akhil, the international calendar. There's just so much of T20 cricket being played these days. I mean, England, Sri Lanka is happening, obviously. You had the PSL happen, just concluded last night. There's a T20 competition happening in Spain. I think it's called the Sofia T20, involving Greece, Serbia, Bulgaria, Romania. I don't know. There's just a lot of T20 cricket being played.
Well, everybody is playing T20 cricket. They're getting ready for the T20 World Cup. As India is also going to be playing a big test series, they are still going to have one more side playing T20 format. So everybody's gearing up for it. I've always been a huge, huge fan of West Indies cricket, and I just love the way that they play their T20 style. So this is one series that I've been looking forward to. They've been really like slammed by the South African team in Test cricket, 2-0 defeat. But it's a completely new setup, isn't it? The West Indies T20 setup. How have West Indies been performing for the last few matches in T20 setup? I remember they won a series versus Sri Lanka, I think, the last time that they played in, and it was a good series for them where they won the third decider match. So yeah, they've won two, they've lost two, and won no result. So mixed results, huh?
And we're talking about the defending champions, right? They won the T20 World Cup. They are the defending champions. But you know, since winning that World Cup under Darren Sammy's captaincy, they haven't quite been able to live up to that standard. You know, since that World Cup win, I don't think they've dominated the format as you'd want them to. You know, the West Indies players are in demand around the world. Talk about Big Bash, talk about IPL, talk about PSL, talk about the Caribbean Premier League, talk about any competition, even in England. But international cricket, it doesn't appear to be, you know, they haven't come together as a team yet. I'm just looking at some results, Akhil. Let me just count down the last 10 or 12 T20 series. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Of the last 12 competitions, T20 competitions, they've won four. That doesn't justify, you know, a defending champion tag.
I think they've been missing most of the big players in all these tournaments because they are busy playing the other leagues, and the ICC tournaments are probably the only time when the rest of the leagues are shut, so all the players then come together and get a chance to play. What I've really enjoyed, Arun, is the change in captaincy. Actually, Kieran Pollard as a captain coming in, I think he's a massive influence on West Indies cricket overall. He's like a big brother influence. Even though I love Jason Holder as a captain, he brought a lot of calmness to it. But while you talk about these last 10 to 12 series, I think what Pollard is now trying to put is he's got the core back together. I mean, ignore the win-loss record for a second, but he's the one who's influenced them to get back Darren Bravo in the squad. If you remember, whatever he did, talk to the selectors, he spoke to the board, he's got Bravo back into the ninth seat, into the team, and it's going to be a massive, massive thing with Pollard being a captain. He's played so much of T20 cricket, and it's like an all-star level, the West Indies, isn't it?
Pollard as captain is refreshing. Just the attitude. He pushes himself, right? He pushes himself on the field. He was a reluctant bowler, but when you saw him captaining Mumbai, he also came on to bowl. We've seen it happen, you know, every now and then. So that's the kind of player he is. I'll just narrate a small story since you brought up Pollard as captain. In the West Indies last year, we were talking about West Indies cricket and captaincy and all that. And in the commentary box, one legend mentioned during a test match that KP needs to be made captain. No, I'm talking test match cricket. And in the West Indies team at that point was Kyron Powell. Imagine how stupid of me that to actually for a second imagine that Kyron Powell will be made captain when people were actually talking about bringing Kyron Pollard to be made captain. You know, people rate him highly in that part of the world. As captain, he's got a good head, doesn't give up.
Yes, if you remember, Arun, on this same show, we were talking about when he was captain during one of the games in the Indian T20 League. And if you remember, he kept a silly point. He kept a slip for a leg spinner, Rahul Chahar, who was attacking the batsman, if you remember. And we spoke about this, where the ball almost went to slip and was caught. And the next ball, the batsman got a caught and bowled opportunity. So these kind of memories stick, right? When T20 formats, you see attacking captains. And I think his batting has also evolved in the last couple of years. There was a recent T20 series that West Indies played in New Zealand. And he was in red hot form. The grounds were small and he was blasting away sixes at will, chasing high totals. So Pollard as a captain, I think is a fantastic move. I hope he does well in this series.
It doesn't matter if the grounds big, grounds small.
You know, for Pollard, him it doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter at all. If Pollard wants to clear it, he'll make sure the ball goes over the stadium, not the boundary line. But
that's the case for everyone, right? In their team?
Right? Just look at the lineup they've selected, Akhil. The squad announcement happened late. I'm not even sure if it happened officially, but you know, it's been circulated around now. But look at the team they've got. Wow. Nicholas Puran, Fabian Allen, Dwayne Bravo, you mentioned. We'll come back to him in a second. I've got a couple of thoughts. Andre Fletcher, Chris Gayle is still there. Can you believe this? We're talking about Chris Gayle still being relevant. Shimran Hetmyer, Jason Holder can do a bit of damage with bat and ball. Evan Lewis, Lendl Simmons. No, there's so much of batting, you know.
Ray Russ.
Batting, which can decimate a position. It's not about just hitting one or two sixes. But if they get going, that one player will ensure the opposition's got no chance whatsoever.
Absolutely. I mean, we discussed the strike rates in our last podcast. But the strike rates of these West Indies, discussed the strike rates of the English batsmen, if you remember. And these are the strike rates for the West Indies batsmen. I mean, these are like real numbers which could be the envy for any team management. I mean, you have one batsman who strikes big like a Chris Gayle, but here you have a Pollard, 137. There's Evan Lewis, who's himself a match winner. And then, of course, you have Russell. So it's a very, very enviable batting order that they've put together.
They've got options available, but I'll say don't be misled by those numbers. Couple of the numbers were 111, 120, 130. But on their day, and that day comes, let's say, twice out of three matches, you know, these batsmen will pummel the opposition. Absolutely pummel the opposition. And, which is what you want to see in T20 cricket, right?
Well,
you want to see batsmen getting those boundaries and sixes.
Absolutely. I mean, Hetmyer and Puran are the future for T20 cricket in the West Indies. I think those two are just capable of winning them the T20 World Cup. So yes, I think West Indies is a team that we can talk a lot about. What about their opposition? South Africa in a rebuilding phase. Again, a new captain that they have for this format. They've just won a overseas series after a long, long time. So, a little bit of cheer coming to Mark Boucher and his support team. I mean, South Africa have been an honest team for so many years, Arun. I think they deserve to start coming back in the elite form of the top two, top three cricket sides, because they've always been a hard-working team. Mark Boucher has put all his weight behind trying to do whatever they needed to get the team going at the top. So, any thoughts about how has South Africa performed in the T20 format?
Not great again, Akhil. Disappointingly not great. Just looking at their last six T20 international series, they've lost the last five. They drew one against India, one match apiece. So last six series, they've had very little success in terms of the title itself, the trophy itself. So like you said, new captain. I don't know what's happening. Let me just read out what's happened with captaincy. They had Henry Klassen as captain not too long ago. They had Quinton de Kock, They had David Miller step in for a brief while. They had JP Duminy. Before that, they had Faf du Plessis. I mean, there's so much of chopping and changing. That I know a few players have stepped in. They've had issues with players migrating to England. All that's happened. But you cannot have so many different captains over a short period of time.
Yeah, and I mean, the tragic part is, and I mean, this could take an entire 20-25 minutes of our time talking about it, is they have like the biggest T20 superstar back at home in South Africa who cannot play this format. They also have Faf du Plessis, if you remember, Arun, who is a accomplished T20 player who performs everywhere in all the leagues. But again, he's not a part of the squad, even though he's fit. And I don't know his willingness to play for the team now, because I don't think he's announced retirement. But he's still fighting fit. We've seen how he's performed for the Chennai Super Kings whenever he's had a chance. So, what about the South African team? How's the team coping without these two huge batsmen?
Before we look at the squad, I just want to draw your attention to two things, Akhil. Looking at the T20I rankings, the ICC T20I rankings, South Africa are sixth, and West Indies, the defending champions, are 10th in the world. That's how bad either these two teams have been in recent past. That tells you.
Yeah, but with the rankings don't matter, isn't it? They are like the Goran Ivanisevic of Wimbledon. They'll get a wild card and they can still go and win the title.
Absolutely, absolutely right. Sorry, you were talking about the South African squad. Let's look at the side that they've picked, you know, for the series. New captain we mentioned, but there's still Quinton de Kock. Few good names there. Henrik Claassen still there. Rassie van der Dusen is a good player.
Yes.
Yeah, Rassie van der Dusen is a really good player. David Miller, experienced, and he seems to be coming good now. I've not always rated him, I'll be honest. I've always thought he's been disappointing, not delivered to his potential, but he seems to be coming good now. So David Miller's there. Aiden Markram can be a hit and miss. So, but they've got a decent team, right? I like the bowling attack more. There's Rabada, there's Ngidi. There's a lot of good bowlers there.
Yeah. And they have one guy I always enjoy watching in T20 is Shamsi. I think he does a good job whenever he plays a T20 format. He gives them an attacking option, which is the wrist spinner in T20, which always, it's worked for most teams. Also, I mean, one underrated performer, Arun, is this Andy Felkuayo, who I have trouble pronouncing his correct name, but I think he's a valuable asset. He's not like a Lance Klusener who'll go and slam a lot of sixes, but he gives them an all-rounder option, which they've always had so many all-rounders. But he bats at number 7, bowls 4 important overs for them. So he provides them a good cushion.
You mentioned Felkuayo, you had trouble with his name. Let me tell you another story. You know, I don't know if his name is to be pronounced as Felkuayo, or Peshuayo. If you look up his name on YouTube, there's a South African award. There's a kind of a documentary done, in which he himself calls his name out as Andile Peshuayo. Now, when we were working on, I was working on regional broadcast a couple of years ago, we didn't know what to do because the world was calling him Felkuayo and we were going Peshuayo. So anyway, but handy cricketer, like you mentioned, really handy cricketer. Can you know, he's in that, I don't know if it's right to compare him and put him in that Vernon Philander mode. But very useful bowler and can do some damage with the bat.
Yes, and I'd love also like to look at the strike rates for their batsmen like we did for the West Indies. Arun, I really, really like watching Claassen bat. I think that guy has solid potential. I mean, we are looking at his strike rate 151. It is outstanding. He can keep wickets also whenever required, if you remember. I think he's a little blowhard, blow cold. When he scores, he really scores. Otherwise, he doesn't. But these are not bad strike rates. They are all, all of them are above 130 except Reza Hendricks, who I don't think has played too much. But all of them are striking over 130, which is impressive.
You spoke about Claassen, Akhil. You remember the damage he caused in that series against India? Which kind of put him under the spotlight and he eventually earned him an IPL contract? Yeah. He's a dangerous player. But again, they've all been hot and cold. You know, that's been the problem with them. Much like West Indies batsmen, if it's their day, they can run away with the game. But with South African players, it's hot and cold as well. You know, they're not like a Babar Azam, if I can say so, or a Virat Kohli or a Rohit Sharma, or a Shikhar Dhawan for that matter, or a KL Rahul. I mean, we've got so many names from our part of the world. They need an accumulator. They need a player who can stay there, play 14, 15 overs and allow others to play around that one batsman or two batsmen.
Yeah. I mean, we've seen the impact of captaincy being taken away from Clinton de Kock in the test format, where he's turned match-winning performances in both the test matches. Again, I'm looking forward to watching him bat. He's always been an impact player for them. So maybe as he grows older, his role in the team might change. And like you're saying, they need somebody to bat through the innings with still the capability of batting at over 130 strike rate. And de Kock does offer that potential for them.
He's done that in the past and no reason why he can't do it again. He's done that in India as well in the IPL. So, you know, if one of them holds, you know, holds four, could be a Quinton de Kock, could be a Aidan Markram, could be whoever, Rassie van der Dusen. If they hold four, South Africa will be in a good position to post 150, 160, 170 regularly. That's what they need.
Yeah, I mean, this is a contest, Arun, I'm really looking forward to, you know, because while Rabada has not spoken about much in T20 cricket for international games, we've seen how effective he has been for Delhi wherever he's bowled here. So, him bowling in the death versus Andre Russell, Kyron Pollard, Shimron Hetmeyer, if they last till the death overs, this is a contest I'm really, really looking forward to.
Absolutely. I want to bring back that South African squad again. Just look at the bowlers once again. We spoke about Rabada, obviously. Let me just try and read out Rabada's numbers in T20 cricket. 26 cricket. Matches. Sorry, in T20 international. 26 matches, 31 wickets. Wicket every 3 overs. But he's a far, far better bowler than that. We've seen him do that in the IPL. We've seen him do that in other competitions as well. So Rabada for one. But there's also other bowlers. If we bring up the team again, there's Ngidi. I actually think Lungi Ngidi is not rated as much as a few of the other bowlers. You know, he can do his job again.
In the top.
Correct. And then you spoke about Tabrez Shamsi. Obviously, you know, Tabrez Shamsi is the world's top ranked bowler now in T20 cricket, T20 international. So they've got a good attack. They've got an attack that can do some damage. It's about everything coming together, much like the West Indies. It can't be one player. No, it's got to be coming together of the team. You know, players can win you matches, but to be a force, you don't need 11 players to come together. You need 3 or 4 players to come good in a match. Hopefully, we'll see that happening in the series.
We'll see that happening, Arun. And before I ask you for your pick for this series, one interesting point which we've also spoken about one of our previous sessions is the costliest player in the Indian T20 League, the costliest overseas player. He's a South African. Where is he? He's not featuring in the national squad.
And are we talking about a certain Chris Morris? That's the name you're looking forward to, right?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Is it maybe. Why is it Chris Morris not considered for his national team? I suppose he's fit. When the league starts again in India, I'm sure he's going to be back playing for the Royals. So it's a tragedy that they have still not been able to get Chris Morris in this side back. He's going to be a vital asset if they had.
They've lost so many such players, Akhil. Let's not even get there. So many better players should be finding place in that squad. They've not, but that's a discussion for another day. You made your point, okay. Though. Chris Morris should have been there.
Yes, absolutely. So let's wrap this session. And who are you picking?
Does the color of my t-shirt tell you anything at all? I mean, it might not be the actual color, but is it anywhere close?
Yes, always the Caribbean color, this one for me. And that's my pick also. I hope it's an entertaining series though. I hope the pitches are good so that the batsmen can play their strokes, and it also should give some chance for the bowlers. So I hope to all, and then fifth match we get a result in the last over. So looking forward to an entertaining series, West Indies, for both of us there.
I hope that happens. We will come back and talk about it again.
Absolutely. See you soon. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye-bye.